We first learned that sine x is the ratio of the opposite side to the hypotenuse of a right-angled triangle. But a lot of you might also know that sine x can be written in the form of this series. They seem to be so unrelated to each other. How did we get from the geometric definition to this series? The standard answer is, go study analysis, but is there an alternative? Yes, of course, otherwise I wouldn't be making this video. And this alternative even tells you what each term in the series means geometrically. The first step is actually to recall how to measure angles in radian. After all, this x here has to be in radian for the series to make sense. To begin, we have a circle centered at the origin. It's important that this is a unit circle, having radius 1. How do we measure an angle then? In radian, we simply look at the length of the arc subtended, which means that if the arc length is x, then we say that the angle is x. There is just one more thing to set up before the power series. What is sine x? Well, we drop a perpendicular and a right-angled triangle appears. Sine x is the ratio of the opposite side to the hypotenuse, and in this case, the opposite side is the vertical segment, while the hypotenuse is a radius, so it has length 1. This means that sine x is just the opposite side. But it might be better to think of this as the y-coordinate of this point at the top, because now we only need to rely on this point, making the diagram cleaner, and even if x is not acute, we can still define what sine x is, but for this video, we are focusing on acute angles, only because the diagram will be much less messy. And now we see the main idea first, and fill in some missing details later on. We go back to our original picture, and this is the wild idea. Imagine this is a circular wall, and we have a purple taut string wrapping against the wall. Now we unwrap the string while keeping it taut and the bottom point fixed. Because the string is kept taut throughout, the vertical segment should still have length x. But let's go back to before the unwrapping. This time, we want to track the tip of the string, which leaves this yellow trace behind. A curve formed this way is usually called an involute. Quite interestingly, its length is x squared over 2 factorial. We'll talk about how to find this length later. Now we zoom into the involute we just created. This time, however, we treat the newly created involute as another wall, and wrap another taut string against it. And again, we unwrap this string, tracking where the tip is going. As said before, the length of this wall is x squared over 2 factorial, so the horizontal segment has the same length of x squared over 2 factorial. But what about the involute that we created? This has length x cubed over 3 factorial. Again, the reason will be explained later. Hopefully you can see the pattern here. Again, we want to focus on our newly created involute and wrap a string around this wall and unwrap the string, keeping it taut and tracking where the tip has gone, giving us another involute. As said before, the length of this involute is x cubed over 3 factorial, so the length of the vertical segment is also x cubed over 3 factorial. But now, the newly created involute has length x to the power 4 over 4 factorial, and we just keep going. Let's zoom out to get the bigger picture. Wait, what are we doing again? Alright, sine x. In the previous section, we established that sine x is the y-coordinate of the red dot here. What we have done with the involutes is that we know this vertical segment has length x, and then the horizontal segment has length x squared over 2 factorial, and we go down this vertical segment which has length x cubed over 3 factorial and so on. But because we only want the y-coordinate, we only need to care about the vertical segments. So sine x, being the y-coordinate of the red dot, is obtained by first adding x, which goes above the point, then subtract x cubed over 3 factorial, which goes slightly below the red dot. So we need to add x to the power 5 over 5 factorial, which goes ever so slightly above the red dot, and so on. So we demonstrated why sine x has this power series, and even explained what each term means geometrically. In fact, exactly the same diagram tells you the power series for cosine, just that we use the horizontal segments instead. This is a very beautiful demonstration, but now comes the question. Why are these lengths x to the n over n factorial in the first place? To find the lengths of all these involutes, the idea would be to approximate the smooth walls as jagged lines, and then make the approximations finer and finer so that the involutes become smooth again. But let's go back to the jagged wall, which approximates the circular arc. In this illustration, we used 5 straight lines to approximate, but any number of lines will do. 5 is such that the jaggedness is still somewhat visible. So again, we wrap our purple string around this wall, but unwrap it in stages. We unwrap until it forms a straight line with the next segment down the line. Now, technically, the involute formed should be a circular arc, but we are pretending it is a straight line. This is only an approximation anyway, and the difference wouldn't matter much when we increase the number of segments. The second stage is similar, just that this time, the straight segment is longer now. Again, we pretend this new part of the involute is a straight line. Unwrap this further until the whole string becomes just a straight line. This finishes the first involute. And to do the second involute, the procedure is exactly the same, which is why it is important that we pretend these are straight lines so that we have exactly the same configuration. The only difference is that these lines have different lengths. Anyway, again we wrap our string around this jagged involute wall and unwrap the string in stages. In any of these involutes, the configuration is exactly the same as the first one, with the only difference being that the lengths of the segments might not be the same, or the whole setup is rotated. So we'll just use this diagram to see how we can go from the mth involute to the m plus 1th involute. Here, for convenience, we'll call the first jagged wall the 0th involute, even though it is not really an involute. Throughout this process, we will see a lot of triangles, all of them being similar. They all look like this, an isosceles triangle with the angle at the tip being x over n. In this case, n is equal to 5 because that is how many segments we have divided the original circular wall into. But n can be any integer in this argument. Anyway, in our arguments later, we often have the scenario where the length of the legs is known, but we want to find the length of the base because that's part of the involute. Let's say the leg has length L, then by bisecting the angle, we can identify a right angle triangle. So this length is L sine x over 2n, and the whole base has length 2L sine x over 2n, i.e. we just multiply the legs by 2 sine x over 2n to get the base. With that, let's go back and see how to compute the length of the next involute down the line. Let's call these lengths L1, L2, and so on. First, zoom in to get a better look at the smaller triangles. In our first step, we see this isosceles triangle, and from just a minute ago, the base should have length 2L1 sine x over 2n. Next up, we get this bigger isosceles triangle. This time, however, the leg has length L1 plus L2, so this part of the involute has length 2 times L1 plus L2 sine x over 2n. Very similarly, we can compute the lengths of the other parts of the involute. So we now know how to go from one involute to the next, and here is the summary. L1, L2, and so on are the lengths of the current parts of the involute. And for the next involute, we get these sine x over 2n stuff as seen before. But you might notice a bit of quirk here. While we have 5 segments at the start, the next involute is going to only have 4 segments. This comes down to how we did the unwrapping procedure. We have already stopped when the string formed a line with L5. But in any case, this tells us how to go from one involute to the next. Which means that we should go back to the first jagged wall, and then repeatedly apply what we have seen. For this initial configuration, we see all these isosceles triangles. In this case, the L's are the bases of the isosceles triangles. The leg is a radius of the unit circle, so it has length 1. So L1 has length 2 sine x over 2n, and of course, all the other L's have the same length. Now we simply apply this procedure to obtain the length of the next involute. In our case, all these L's are 2 sine x over 2n, which, to be honest, looks clumsy, so I'm going to use lambda to denote that. So we can make the first column cleaner, but actually we can also clean up the second column. For instance, this is just lambda L1. And similarly, we can represent all these in terms of lambda and the L's. In this first iteration, the L's are all lambda, so the first row gives lambda squared, and the second row gives 2 lambda squared, again because L1 and L2 are both lambda. And we fill in the rest. I think it's worth reiterating what we are doing with this iteration. These lambda squared, 2 lambda squared, and so on actually correspond to the length of these yellow segments generated by the unwrapping of the current involute. If we want the lengths of the segments for the next involute, we simply substitute the lambda squared, 2 lambda squared stuff into this column and iterate. So now, we have replaced the first column by the data from the yellow involute, and we throw into this scheme. The first row gives lambda cubed. For the second row, we need to be slightly more careful. L1 plus L2 here means summing up the first 2 entries in the first column, so this actually gives 3 lambda cubed. For the next one, we instead need to sum up the first 3 entries, so we get 6 lambda cubed. Very similarly, the fourth row gives 10 lambda cubed. Again, what we are doing is that if the current involute has all these lengths, then the next involute would have these lengths, which is exactly the lengths of these segments here. But if we now only look at the coefficients, does it ring a bell? Maybe not. So here is the summary. The zeroth involute has segments of length lambda, while the first involute has length lambda squared, 2 lambda squared, and so on, and the second involute has lengths lambda cubed, 3 lambda cubed, and so on. To make the pattern clearer, let's do one more. For the third involute, first row is just this box multiplied by lambda, so it is lambda to the 4. And then, the next one will be the sum of these two, multiplied by lambda, so 4 lambda to the 4, and so on. Now, let's look at the full table, focusing only on the coefficients. The first entry is 1, and the next diagonal has coefficients 1 and 1, then 1, 2, 1, then 1, 3, 3, 1. The coefficients form exactly the Pascal's triangle. This is, of course, not a coincidence. The first rows and columns all have coefficients 1, and the way we compute the other coefficients are the same. For example, the way that we computed 35 was to sum up the right amount of coefficients in the previous column. But computing 20 follows a similar procedure of summing the previous column. The only difference is we haven't included 15. So to get 35, we simply add up the coefficient above it and the one to the left, which is exactly how the Pascal's triangle is constructed. We know that the Pascal's triangle has n choose r as the entries. Here, n refers to which diagonal we are on, but we count from 0. So this is the 0th diagonal. This is the first diagonal. This is the second diagonal, and so on. The r in this case refers to which entry on the diagonal, again counting from 0. So this is the 0th entry, the first entry, the second entry, and the third one. Or you can think of it as being in the third involute column, so it is the third entry. However, these are only the lengths of little segments of the involute. To calculate the total length of, say, the 0th involute, we need to add up everything in this column. If we only consider the coefficient, it is 5, the entry to the right. What about the total length of the first involute? It should be adding up the first 4 entries here, because moving from one involute to the next removes one entry, as seen before. Again, this is just the coefficient of the entry to the right. And we can continue this process. But now note that these are entries on the same diagonal, actually, the 5th diagonal. Look, 0th, 1st, 2nd, 3rd, 4th, and 5th. So the entries here are 5 choose 1, 5 choose 2, and 5 choose 3 respectively. So the total length of the 0th involute is 5 choose 1 times lambda. The total length of the first involute is 5 choose 2 times lambda squared. And very similarly, the total length of the second involute is 5 choose 3 times lambda cubed, and so on. And in general, the total length of the kth involute is n choose k plus 1 times lambda to the k plus 1. Here, n is the number of segments in the 0th involute, just that we chose n to be 5 in the beginning. But in any case, we want to let n bigger and bigger so that it approximates the real involutes better and better. So we focus on this expression over here, noting that lambda is an abbreviation for 2 sine x over 2n. This is really the final calculation that we are going to do. The first step is to expand everything. But don't be intimidated, the first bit here is simply n choose k plus 1. And this yellow bracket here is just lambda. The next step looks even more intimidating, but again, it isn't really. What we have done is that we want to divide the purple box here by n to the k plus 1, but since we have exactly k plus 1 brackets, we just divide every bracket by n. For the yellow part, we have to multiply our n to the k plus 1 back, which can be done by just putting the n in the bracket. But what is 2n sine x over 2n? This is precisely the total length of the 0th involute, because as we have found earlier, the length of each segment is 2 sine x over 2n, and there are n of these segments. So as n grows bigger, it is supposed to be an actual circular arc. Since the angle of the arc is x, the true circular arc has length x by definition. So going back to our calculation, the yellow box tends to x to the k plus 1 as n grows bigger and bigger, and the purple box goes towards 1 over k plus 1 factorial, because when n grows much bigger than k, all the brackets tend to 1. So there you have it, the k-th true involute has length x to the k plus 1 over k plus 1 factorial, which is exactly what I have claimed in the main sketch of the proof. The proof is way too unknown, which is why I wanted to bring this up. If you think this deserves to be seen by more people, like, comment, and share. And there is another reason why you might want to do this, which is that this video is a fundraiser for UNICEF, more specifically, for the children in Ukraine. I won't say much about the war because it will get me demonetized, and 50% of this video's ad revenue will go towards UNICEF, so obviously I don't want to get this video demonetized. UNICEF has been working on providing essential physical supplies as well as psychosocial support for families and separated children. If this is something that you also believe in, do consider donating. There should be a donate button somewhere around this video, depending on your device. If you can't donate but still want to support this cause, the usual subscribe, bell, like, comment, share would also help this video reach more people. Thank you for watching, and I'll see you next time. Bye!